Thank you. Thank you, Leo. Yeah, welcome everybody. Honestly, as I talked to my friends and I said to them, well, I'm holding a talk about metrics. First there was silence, and then there was some answer like, are you kidding? Are you insane? And I said, no, I think this is an important topic. And I mean, it's a little bit dry sometimes, yeah, but it depends on how deep you go into the topic. And what I will like to present you today is like a rough overview. So my goal is not that you going out of the session and saying, well, I know all these metrics Alex showed me and I can repeat them and I have the definition in my head. No, I want to create some awareness that they are there, that they can help you, and that you probably can look it up if you need them. Talking about the topic talking about me, well, as you already might have seen, I'm working with that actually cool company. See a lot of these building blocks here, and I just heard a few minutes ago that also a lot of colleagues are here. So Accenture guys, just raise your hand. Who's here, Accenture?
Whoa.
Ooh, okay. So, I myself, I'm working with Accenture for a very, very long time. I just reference this as more of a decade. And half of the time, I'm was kind of lucky to be in the Agile space or doing something around agility. Yeah, not having done Scrum for the full time, not Kanban, but there's a lot out there. As we heard from Pavel, it's a lot about practices, agile practices, principles you can apply, and you don't have to talk to the client and say, well, we're doing agile now, just do it, because it's something that works. That's what I found out. So, normally I'm holding talks about large-scale agile, setting up agile projects, that's where I came from, but in my current role, I'm also kind of an agile project manager. So I'm still coaching teams. I wouldn't say I'm the best Scrum Master. Yeah, I'm not, but I know a lot about how to set up projects. And one of the pieces there is metrics. Yeah, and talking about metrics, the first thing, and especially if you combine it with agile, is why metrics? Are they needed? And I think for my talk, there are a few assumptions I made. Well, just imagine if you're sitting in a garage, three of your friends are there, yeah, you're hearing music, it somehow looks crowded in some way, but you're programming something, yeah, you're developing, you're doing some new app stuff, whatever, you want to release it. So do you need metrics there? Probably not, yeah. Where I come from, it's an area where we do large-scale projects, and we're doing that with Agile. My current project has 13 Scrum teams working on one code base, so meaning working on one product which they want to release. And that's a huge thing, right? It's large. And it's not three people. Within your three people, you may want to have the goal of doing something innovative. Well, that's good. Use Agile there, use Scrum there. That's exactly what it's built for. But more often out there, what I see with clients, that we use Scrum also as kind of a delivery mechanism. Yeah, a way to deliver some scope, some stuff, some products. Well, it works. I don't think it really realizes the full benefits of Scrum, but it works. But exactly for these scenarios, if you're working for somebody, if you're delivering something to somebody, and it's in a larger space, you have more teams, you have more people, the project is half a year or longer, it makes sense to measure a little bit and to make informed decisions. And that's why I cited here Eric Ries. Yeah, you may have heard him from Lean Startup. So it's a little bit more about startup and innovation, doing new stuff. But basically he says, metrics help to make decisions. And decisions are, for example, if somebody comes to your garage and says, hey, I give you some money, then at the second time you meet him, probably he will ask you, what have you done with my money? How much money did you spend? And what was actually the output? Can you show me? And if you work in an agile mode, it's great because you can show him something. Yeah, you've built something. It's working software revalue. Talking about money and budget, there's also this thing like, imagine your garage team is hired to do some kind of Christmas app. So what does that mean? That does mean you have a schedule, you have a deadline, you have a fixed date, and you may want to prepare for that. If it's just a 2 hours job or a 2 days job, never mind, not talking about metrics. But if it's a job that takes you a few weeks, you better look into. So that's the reason why I think you should care about metrics. You should care about a lot of them, but some of them are useful. Metrics actually for what? I recognize it's not easily visible, but to kind of take you a little bit away from the garage team to a space which is my kind of space. So it's a project, right? We have several months, and it's probably going on. We have several releases, and within the releases, we're doing just what good agile teams should do. And now I'm assuming we're doing Scrum. Yeah, not talking about Kanban. Scrum is like, let's say, the most spread agile methodology out there. So you have several sprints. And you see, this could be huge from a length perspective. It could be years, this project. Nevertheless, you want to release as often as you can. Perhaps you're doing not that often releases as Amazon or eBay, but you want to do it more often. And scaling in the other direction, you have a lot of people working in there. So it's a lot of money you actually should control somehow if you're leading that. Well, which metrics to take? There's a lot out there. And I don't want to kind of bore you with too much theory, but some ideas I want to place, and some ideas what makes a good metric. And actually this slide, it was really hard because it was like 10 to 15 items I had initially on this slide, but I thought kind of I threw something out and leave it to this. Well, we still want to remain agile, and agile doesn't mean we're doing a lot of overhead, a lot of collecting numbers and forcing people to write down something. So yes, sometimes you need metrics, but as many as required, but as less as possible. So be clear, it's the same idea behind, does Agile need documentation? Well, yes, at some point it needs it, but do as less as you can do. Does do just what makes sense. So the same question you should ask yourself when talking about how, what should I document in an Agile project, ask yourself the same questions in the metric space. What should I measure? What's really important to me? Where are my pain points? What am I afraid of? And measure that. Thing I like really is measure results, not activity. I recently seen an Agile project and they measured how often they're doing daily scrums, so daily stand-ups. So who thinks that this is useful? Well,
it is if they are not doing them daily.
It somehow contradicts what you have told us before, but yeah, raising a few hands is okay because there might be a reason for that. I don't know the reason, and honestly, they hadn't won. Yes, so so that's exactly, that's measuring activity. But what you should measure are results. So what's the outcome? What's the business value? I mean, business value is the highest thing, but in a project landscape, there are often more things to measure. Another thing is, which I like also, and this is kind of some buzzwords here, leading indicators over trailing indicators. Often you find some metrics, they tell you now that you're in deep trouble. Cool. Yeah, I know it already because I'm in deep trouble. So that's basically a trailing indicator because it's too late. So the leading indicator tell you in advance that you're facing, that you're heading some troubles. So check your metrics, it's like short check. Does it tell me something for the future or does it try to forecast something? And that makes sense. The other one just, yeah, you know it when you're there. But wait, Alex, so if you want to talk about metrics and you said you want to talk about Scrum, there are already metrics. So we have the burn down thing, burn down graph, we have that velocity. Well, that's cool, that should be enough because, well, Scrum says that, we have a Scrum guide, it's in there, should be enough. So asking you, who's on a Scrum project at the moment, or producing, or where was on a Scrum project? Just raise your hands. Half of, okay, so leave it. Raise your hands and keep it. Have you? Is it only these two metrics you have on these projects? If yes, leave it. You don't know. Okay, let me think about that. We have to talk later. I guess. So, interesting. A lot of you put your hand down. So let's see, because that means I have to convince you, let's see what I have to bring to you, because I think for the cases I just described, so for large scale or long running projects, you should have more metrics. The reason is, Scrum is an agile project management framework. It's not an agile engineering, not an agile software methodology framework, it's first and foremost, and project management. So, and I'm afraid of combining things that I learned. And things that I learned is, well, there is this PMI, PMP, project management framework, and it's not agile. Yeah, I know. But they have SAP now, thanks. So they kind of corrected a few years ago. But looking at that PMP stuff, they have the good thing to kind of take different viewpoints. And some of the viewpoints I've listed here because I think they are the key viewpoints, the key dimensions that you may want to look at your project. It's the scope, it's the cost, it's the schedule, it's the quality, and probably the productivity. So that's the key dimensions. I don't recommend you should measure all of them. You need the metrics for all of them for your projects. But look carefully because some of them you would need. For example, the Christmas app, probably you need a metric for your schedule. And the guy who gave you money, probably you need a schedule for cost. So what I'm proposing here is a kind of a minimal set of metrics. And minimal means that's the minimal set for all large scale projects. It is not the minimal set for your garage system, right? And it consists of these metrics. So you see, for scope and cost, I just propose one metric to measure this project management area. So you see me a little bit hesitating. Scope, quality, cost, schedule, they are fine with me. I'm a little bit struggling about productivity. So I'm asking you, is it good to measure productivity? Who thinks it's good? Only some of you. Well, me as a consultant, I say it depends. Well, it's not good to measure productivity perhaps of a single individual. And it's also probably not good if you measure teams' productivity in a way that you compare teams against each other. Could be, like, yeah, make a competition. Is it gamification? Can I use it? Oh, I'm not sure, I wouldn't do it. But overall productivity of your project, that makes sense for me. So let's start with productivity. And it's kind of a means to an end. Productivity is contains the first of the metrics I propose. It's called sprint productivity, and it's actually an easy one, right? Sprint productivity is the value of story points in contrast to the effort, to the effort of hours you spend. So it's an easy calculation, story points of a sprint divided by person days of a sprint. So it's a calculation you probably do anyway, because when you're calculating your velocity, you just kind of have to normalize the velocity and adjust it for vacations or absences. You see in the graph down there, you can also talk about planned productivity. So if you set up a new project and you want to see, okay, where do I land, how much should I probably work in these hours in order to meet the plan, I can do a planned productivity. So looking a little bit into the future in forecasting, I can also talk about required productivity. And required is, in my case, a story point estimate of must-have user stories and a total planned of remaining efforts. To use the official terms, with this metric you can check if you are able to build a minimum viable product, or a minimal marketable feature, MMF or MVP. My personal is, since we are releasing software, or in my area, we do not release a complete product. We do releases. So I call it just minimal viable release. So are you able to hold perhaps the promises of some features? I don't say user stories, I say feature, so a high level thing of the minimal viable release. So it looks a little bit dry. So that's why I switched to an example. Let's assume this is a backlog. A backlog, you can see we already worked a little bit. There's a done column, check marked, so we have already succeeded in getting something done. But we're still in sprint 3, and we're still about to deliver sprint 4, 5, and 6. They are open. So they are lying ahead of us. If we use the required productivity, I just use the follow-up estimates, so the estimates of the next user stories, but I don't use this one because it's a could have. I just say, well, that's not really required, so I don't calculate it. So what I can do is, using these metrics, I can calculate a required productivity which says what is my effort of time I need basically in order to deliver this amount of user stories in the next 3 sprints. So the result is a number. So now I have 2 numbers. What am I doing with that? And the reason is why I said productivity is means to an end is I'm using these 2 numbers to have actually a cool metric, and we call it release slippage risk indicator. And that's the first metrics for your schedule, and it tells you if you really hit the point, meaning from a schedule perspective, are you able to deliver a minimal product at the fixed date. And what it just does is it takes the early 2 identified metrics and just divides it. So what is your past sprint productivity? How good are you? How good is your productivity? And I mean, I like the idea of the past sprint. You could do an average of your sprints, but probably if you're setting up a team for the first time, you have some calibration time. You have some 2 or 3 sprints where the team is not really working up to their expectations or to the overall expectations. They probably don't deliver their commitment and they are not improved. So they are improving constantly, and you're using what's extreme programming called yesterday's weather, so the past sprint productivity. And then you're looking forward and seeing, okay, what's actually required productivity if I use or look at my must-haves. And then you get a number. And the number is, as it says, an indicator. An indicator just means when I'm in the area of one, then I'm something which says, okay, is this as planned? Smaller is delayed, and larger is ahead of plan, so I'm actually faster. So let's look how that translates to the example we had. And actually the calculations, you have seen them before. That's again required productivity and past productivity. And you see the slippage risk is 1.00, just a reminder. So we are ahead of plan here. But looking at what I did, and that's what I showed you in the red areas, in the past we worked with an average of 90 hours. You have to check what you calculate, that's team hours. Yeah, you may want to add something, some time with your Scrum Master and Product Owner as well. So I worked with the team's effort within a sprint of 90 hours. And what I did for the future, I was able to unfreeze some person because I work now with 105 hours. So probably one person was just working half the time in my team, now is working full time, and that basically helps me to deliver up and decrease the release slippage risk. So release slippage is basically answers the question, will you deliver from the current productivity or from your current velocity based, will you deliver on time? Actually, there's an easier way to get this number, but I presented you the complicated one first. Because the easy way is just a division which says, I use all the story points completed so far in the release. So all what I have done, all user stories which are done. And then I divide it by the story points planned in the release. So that's easy. That's also a schedule. And then I know, am I ahead of the plan or am I behind of the plan? So I know it's dry stuff and probably it's hard to digest, but a question to you, why do I think this is not so available, this metric, as the one before? Even if both are showing me the schedule or if I'm able to hold the schedule. Any ideas? Yeah. So the idea is this is a little bit rough. Yeah. You remember I told you when you set up a new team, you have to calibrate the team, and this doesn't take into account the calibration. It just says I look at what you have achieved so far, and it doesn't look about on yesterday's weather because we already may have improved as team. Yeah. We may have grown. We are better now, we are already in sprint 3 or 4, we know what to do, we know the scope, the domain, the technology. So with this formula, you just say, okay, I average everything out. Yeah? So if you want to do a quick calculation, this is fine, but if you really want to know how good is your team now, how good was it in the last sprint, if this sprint was significant, then use the other metric. It's a little bit more effort to calculate it, but it's more accurate for doing a guessing, a forecasting of the future. In a way to provide you a few examples, it's heavy, I know, but I nevertheless tried. There is more than a sprint burn down. There's also something for the release. You can draw it as a release burn down, but we used to draw it as a release burn up chart. So again, question, who has seen such release burn-up charts? Who has worked with it? Any hands? Okay. So it's about 5. That's good to explain it. And this is something from reality. So I'm not here to explain the full complexity here. But let's start from top down, right? The top blue lines, this is my scope. So this is the known scope. So kind of probably I don't have it split into user stories, but I have some features or epics or however you would call it. I have done some high level estimates. And the high level estimates bring me to a point which is here or here or here. But basically it's a moving target. Yeah, but that's what we want. Agility is a moving target. Scope is floating. And the two different lines is here. The one is the must scope. So this is my minimal product. So that's what's minimal wanted. And the other one is the total number of all story points for all the scope. So I don't know how you structure your scope. Must have, should have, nice to have, whatever. But this is really the must haves. And for each increase here, we did something like, okay, this chart should know why there was an increase, so we kind of documented it. Yeah. So then we have a lot of lines in here that basically do the same as your sprint burndown chart. Because they look, where are you at the moment, what did you deliver, and what actually could you have delivered when looking at the linear approximation. And looking at this too, we see here the blue line is actually the planned, so what we plan to do. And we have also the green line, this is actually what it's complete. So there's a deviation. Yeah, and the deviation you see here, we have a deviation from a lot of story points. And what I can do using the story points, I can calculate these least burn chart performance indicator. So I have a number 0.68 and I know I'm late. So when my colleagues see the slides, they ask me, Alex, why do you need a number there? We have this chart. Yeah. It's clear. So why do I need this number 0.68? So it's obvious we are behind here. What do you think?
How far?
How far, yes. So it's kind of the relation, yeah? That's the question. That's kind of the project management question, yeah? So often what you have, and I have to say it's a pity, but you have it, you're not able to show this kind of graphs to management because they're just interested in numbers. So, and by showing the graph, a picture tells everything. But if they don't want to see this graph, I need a number, and actually this is the number. Yeah, the graph tells a lot more, but if you are kind of faced to just provide a number, you use this number and do this division. If not, get rid of the number and show them the graph. There's one thing left in the area of schedule, and this is actually what you know. There's a sophisticated name for it. It's sprint burndown performance indicator. But if you see the calculation, it's just the remaining work to the actual work. And that's basically what you all should know, because that's again the number, the project management number, the metric, which is just telling you what your sprint burndown will show you. So again, if you want or are in the need to have a number, you can do that, regardless if you're doing your burndown with hours or with story points. You can do that, you can calculate it, and you see here in this example, easily estimate to complete is higher than the actual ideal burndown line, and if you want to calculate it, you have a deviation of 25%. So again, if you are able to show pictures, show the picture, yeah, show the forecasting line, show the ideal line, that's enough for a sprint burndown, that's by far enough, and it probably tells you more compared to some numbers. So that's all about schedule. And I have one metric for scope. And it's called scope volatility. And scope volatility says how large is the amount, again in the estimate, so again we are in the world of story points, how much is the amount of changed scope, probably since release start or since project start. So what's the name of, in the normal project management world, for this metric? Thanks, I heard it. Yes, it's actually on the slide somewhere, right? Yeah, but that's scope creep, yeah? You could say, well, why care about scope creep? We're agile, yeah? We can change our minds, we can adapt, we can frequently adapt. Yeah, that's the theory, and basically in your garage system you can do it. But in real life, there are deadlines, there are budgets, and you can't just change every day your mind, because that's expensive. Because if you every new day have some new ideas and give it to the team and say, hey, do a prototype, do a functional experiment, just see if the users like this, then they are constantly doing experiments. Which is good for an innovative process, but which is not good if you have a client who has already a kind of envisioned what you're up to. So, basically talking about this metric, it's good to know how much is changing. Yeah, how large is the amount of change? And coming back to that graph, you already know the amount of change can easily be measured because we had one starting point. That's probably where we agreed upon a budget. I wouldn't say that the budget was fixed there, but probably there's some upper limit, and the upper limit will hold you back if you, as you can see here, increase the scope with too much. So that's actually my only metric for scope I will give you, so kind of to prevent scope creep, because I think it's easy to see where you are. Yeah, that's the good thing in Agile. And now, honestly, it comes a very, very nasty thing, and I'm was looking how to present this slide, but I have actually only one slide for cost, but this looks that way. It's a so-called story point performance indicator. And if you're coming from traditional project management, it's just the so-called CPI, which is one of the key performance indicators of project management, but we only calculate it sprint-wise. Yeah. You only have an update on this number for each sprint. And actually the formula looks like this way, but let me directly skip to an example, because basically what this metric does is it takes into account the value you generated and maps it to the effort. And then at the end, see value, that's value creation, we want to do that. The good thing in Agile is it's really value. We have working software. So in the old CPI world, you can measure some documents written, some test cases written, whatever. Now here we have real value generated, and you measure the effort. And yeah, you can use a chart, but you can use also this stuff. Basically, you see we have a planned value, so a planned velocity. We have the current velocity, which is this here. And if I have it in a chart, you see here a sprint-wise chart, and it's growing, which is good. And we also probably know the numbers of some efforts in behind. Yeah, we know how many people worked on that sprints, how many people worked in the user stories, and we have also here a planned effort, probably some absences, some vacations also planned in, and we have the actual effort. If we combine it in the right way, we get this nice little division formula, which basically says that we have a cost overrun here. So now we already spent too much money, and progressing that same way, we will spend also too much money for the whole release or a whole project. So not going into much depths here, but you get the slides afterwards. I think it's useful to have one metric for budget, right? So talking a lot about project management, finally there's also something about quality. What's the quality of your project? And there's one metric that's called running tested features, and I already Googled it for the presentation. It was already also suggested by Ron Jeffries, which was one of the signer of the Agile Manifesto, and he calls it, it's the metric leading to agility. So let's first look on what is it showing. It shows the features we have built and which are still successful, or for which still our regression tests are running successful. So why does Ron Jeff say this metric is leading to agility? I give you two or three reasons. The first reason is this number should steadily grow. When it grows, it means we're generating value because we have more running features, which is good. When it grows, it means also we have more running features that are tested, because we're talking about running tested features. So we have a kind of a safety net or insurance that they are there. And in a way, they continuously should grow. So not kind of it grows in April and the number grows in September again. No, it should continuously grow. We know that we only can achieve this by using agile methods, because continuously growing means for eBay several hundred times a day it's growing because they're delivering that often, and for a Scrum approach where you have a 2-week sprints, it grows every 2 weeks probably. So using that number, you can also divide it into the delivered features and running tested feature, and you can easily paint a graph and say, okay, if this is 71%, that means of my built features, of my actually built, delivered, and done features, only 71% are running regarding to the acceptance or regression tests. This is actually a bad number, so probably some refactoring took place here, somebody checked in a central component, and yeah, it destroyed the build. The last metric is a delivered defect rate. So regardless for what you use Scrum, for which kind of project management, so 90%, 95% of the people are using it for IT project management, but I've seen different applications. But there are always some kind of ways to measure defects. So what I like to measure is not the defect which happen in the Scrum teams while they are producing something. So from my perspective, kind of documenting such defect is an overhead. Don't do it. But after the Scrum team tells me that they are done and they get the approval of the product owner that they are really done, then I'm interested as a project manager in if there are still defects happen. And this actually is this number. So it measures the defects in done stories. And finally, in this case, you have a kind of an course, you have a defect rate. That's just a number, and I can't tell you if the number is good or bad. It's completely up to your environment. But what is interesting is this number stable or does it grow? So does it grow? That would mean with the effort you're currently spending, you're introducing more errors, more bugs, more defects than before. So if you're seeing that, you might want to do a little bit more research and checking out what is wrong. So what I showed you here is, I know it's kind of a quick walkthrough and it's not like the vivid topics, but one takeaway is for you, regardless if you need all these metrics, think about these five areas and think how important they are to you. how important are they to your success of the project, or probably to the one who's paying you for that success? And check which one of them you want to use. I don't say use everything, yeah? Use your head. And in a way that I just used some, I had to leave out some else. And it's kind of just a reminder for you, if you visit the slides, there are a few metrics which me personally I found helpful. And I used some of them, but only at some occasions. And some of them are very agile. Yeah, you see here employee engagement. So yeah, agile is all about motivation, motivating people, motivating teams. It's a people business. Yeah, average time to market, customer satisfaction. So be clear, there are a lot of some more useful metrics out there. This is actually just the ones which I used and which I would say in some areas they helped me. So I don't just copy and paste. So this is the ones I used. Check it out. Check it out against the principles, and hopefully you find the right ones and don't bother people with too much overhead for that metrics. Thanks.
All right. All right. Thank you very much. So we have a space for exactly one question. So make it count. Okay. The girl was a
Okay, so my question is, do you think that is really not over-engineered in your case? Because those metrics seems really complex. And if we have the projects, we usually want to cut complexity, not increase it by adding the complex estimates and actually guesstimates, because as you mentioned as well, estimate is like guessing. So is it actually good to apply sophisticated stuff to stuff that we already are guessing? And yeah, so this is my question.
So yes, basically I have to repeat my last words. See if you need them. If you're working on a project like me with 160 people and the client holds you accountable for the results, you may want to take some informed decisions. And I don't overlook what all happens, and I don't see what all happens. And no, on my project with the 160 people, I'm not using all of these metrics. And this is my second answer. I don't want to propose, or I wouldn't say that any of us here has one project that needs all of them. I don't think so. But probably three or four of them would help. And regarding the complexity, it's all about story points, which you should know.
Yeah. So maybe I clarify my question better, because also I have experience from corporate systems, which are big, and they're kind of the ERP, so the teams are big as well. And what we try to do is basically fit it to the agile way of working. So instead of having like accurate numbers, we are trying to tell to the business, sorry, you won't have the strict deadline. And that's why I'm asking if this, what you're doing, is actually trying to fit the agile to the SAT corporation reality, or do you also by those complex metrics try to convince the people to more flexibility? Because for me, the deadline, the Gantt, which looks like mini waterfall, it's, you know, it seems a bit scary that we are using the word agile for something that in reality is only iterations done on a waterfall manner. So, yeah. I'm sorry for the controversial question, because I know that reality in such companies is usually sad. So yeah, and I think it could be nice.
It's fine. What we, and I'm just answering indirectly. What we all have to keep in mind is that we are in the agile space. We are over there. Yeah, but a lot of people are still here. And we kind of have to talk a language where we talk in the same things or in the same dimensions which they talk. I will not stop educating them, and I will not stop pushing them. But sometimes And yes, it's a pity, and yet it's the large enterprises. Sometimes in these areas, we have to have some, yeah, probably drawbacks, some situations which we don't like. And if I can avoid it, if I can prevent it, and this is my last words, just use the metrics you really need. I didn't say you need all of them, and I didn't say all of them are good. It just, it's completely dependent on your environment. So if you need none of them, perfect.
All right.